instead of specifically focusing on whether it was, you know, the public or private part of this, it's really about the influence of money in our elections.
Enforcement is key. Auditing is key. The system will only work if you put the resources behind the system to make it work.
It's about $10 million to run the office every year, yes.
Every year.
We are auditing the candidates and preparing for the future elections.
Whatever the cost is, whatever the various philosophies of people are, to compel a man to furnish contributions of money for the propagation of opinions which he disbelieves and abhors is sinful and tyrannical. A guy who was a pretty good politician, Thomas Jefferson, said that a few years ago.
So if the worry is corruption, basically, why would you want to give more state tax funds to corrupt politicians? If PJ O'Rourke was here, he'd probably say this is like providing whiskey and car keys to teenage boys.
Your tax dollars financing elections, it's being talked about as a method to fix the wholesale corruption problem in New York. Finance Chairman John DeFrancisco is here to talk about reform. Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. How are you, Senator?
Doing well, thank you.
There are substantial reasons for the public to be concerned about corruption. There's a lot of cases coming out right now. Why don't you tell us what public financing of elections is and how that differs to the system that the state uses?
Well, first of all, public financing, the way it's done in New York City, which is probably the best example, is that if you are a candidate and you have an opponent and you raise a dollar, you can get $6 of public taxpayers' money to match your $1 of contributions. There are certain limits on the amount of each candidate can privately get, which is the basis for having that system, but $6 for every $1. And what happens in that process, there's a lot of things that happen. There are many, very few contested races in New York City, very few. If you're a Democrat and you get the Democrat nomination, you're guaranteed 90% of the vote. So in my opinion, it seems kind of ridiculous to have $6 for every $1 raised of taxpayers' money in a campaign that's not even competitive. So there's a lot of problems with it. And as that quote in the beginning from Thomas Jefferson, you're compelling people to pay for a candidate that they may in not agree with anything about. And quite frankly, this doesn't end the corruption that is alleged to be the basis for this campaign financing. In fact, in some ways, keeps it going.
Right. We do need reform that actually makes a difference. We have a few clips from that hearing that I would like to show. First, you present a scenario to the president of the Center for Competitive Politics.
Let me just give you a couple of examples, and I think these are real examples, and unless I'm misinformed. I happen to be a Democrat in New York City, and I win my race after getting past the primary by 95% to 5%. There's a few write-ins for Mickey Mouse or something. And I can still apply for campaign financing the next year, even though the chances of me losing the race is slim and none. Is that fair to say?
I don't see anything in the proposals that would prohibit that, no.
Okay. Now, I'm going to ask you, this is purely hypothetical now. Just purely hypothetical. Let's suppose, can you think of a motive, any kind of motive or any kind of reason why someone would do this? Suppose the someone contacts a person on a city council and others, and gives that person money for the opportunity to run on a party line that has no chance of winning in that jurisdiction, none whatsoever, but that jurisdiction has public financing of elections. Can you think of any reason that person would want to bribe somebody in order to get into a race that the person has no possible chance of winning?
Well, I would say politicians are often quite clever and very innovative about how to take the rules, whatever the rules might be, and trying to use them to their advantage. Now, I could imagine a case, someone wanting to increase their name ID or favorability or build a base in the state. And if you were to be able to go to donors and say, look, I'm thinking of running for mayor or something in New York, and if you give me a dollar, your contribution will be multiplied by sixfold. I mean, a lot of potential donors would find that attractive if you find that candidate attractive. It's not uncommon, for example, for a congressman who is in a very Republican district or a very Democratic district, has not been opposed heavily, didn't have primary opponents, and they often raise lots of money and build up a big war chest. Well, what are they doing that for? They have no problem getting reelected. And the answer is they have ambitions, and they hope to run for a bigger office someday.
I think the point, and it may come out later in the show, but the point is that the corruption that precipitated all of this, the most recent move for campaign finance reform, is the arrest of Malcolm Smith, who is charged, and only charged at this point, with providing money to a city councilor to get a Republican nomination, he's a Democrat, to run for mayor of the city of Syracuse. Now, mayor of the city of New York. New York has public financing. So public financing is being espoused as some cure-all for the abuses that caused things like the corruption allegations against Malcolm Smith. It just doesn't follow. It seems to me that if there are bad politicians or bad lawyers or bad judges or bad anybody, they should be weeded out, they should be dealt with harshly by the law, and they should pay the penalties that anyone else that breaks the law. But to suggest that someone who's in office already is going to be cured of his evil intent or her evil intent simply because how they get in office is by a public financing scheme, is it just doesn't follow. And that's what my main objection to all of this this hysteria over public financing. The remedy doesn't fit the problem you're trying to correct.
We do need reform. We really do need measures that will make a substantial difference. The executive director of the New York City Campaign Finance Board also spoke at this hearing, and in this clip you ask her about deadline, audits, and investigations.
This recent case with, his name was Lou down in New York City. What did you uncover that particular situation, your office, or was it brought to your attention?
That's a federal prosecution, and our audit of that campaign has not been completed, so I don't feel at liberty to discuss the particulars of that.
So he's been convicted of something?
Two of his campaign staff.
Okay, and you haven't completed your audit yet?
That involves the 2013 campaign. That criminal prosecution involved the 2013 campaign, which is still ongoing.
So it's quicker to prosecute somebody in federal court and get a conviction than it is to get an audit of one of these candidates?
Well, we haven't made any determinations of any public funds payments for the 2013 election yet, because it's not, those determinations will happen this summer.
Wasn't one of the allegations that individuals, instead of money being brought by individuals under the limit, that money he was getting was being broken down into what he portrayed to be individual campaign contributions. Is that fair to say?
Yes.
Have you uncovered any of that yet?
Yeah, I mean, over the years, our program has uncovered, several cases of that. Those kind of schemes of straw donors are rare, and usually they're unsuccessful. I mean, our auditing has caught a number of high profile cases. In 1993, Ron Reale was prosecuted and convicted for a similar kind of straw donor scheme that was uncovered by our office. Sheldon Loeffler, running for Queensborough president in 2001, and Albert Baldeo, who ran in a special election in 2010, is now under indictment because of an uncovering of a straw donor scheme found by our office.
So no matter what the system, if someone's going to be a crook, he can game any system. Is that fair to say? If he's caught, he gets prosecuted.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to claim that the public matching funds program, cleanses out all corruption or, because I think that's an unrealistic standard.
Okay, now.
So are they, is the New York City system attracting any people with higher moral standards because of this method?
That's the point. The cause of the corruption has nothing to do with the supposed remedy. And later on in her testimony, it's very interesting to know that the elections in 2009, it's 4 years ago, there are still 10 candidates who have not, they haven't completed the audit. Mm. Now, if the concept is to root out corruption and bad people getting in politics, if you can't find that till 4 years later, when you're ready to start the next election, it seems that the system will not uncover the corruption in time to keep these types of people out of politics. So it's not the cure-all, and I don't think it's a good system.
Yeah, one example of that would be Assemblyman Lopez, who's being pushed out of the assembly for doing, you know, reportedly doing horrible things to his women staffers, and now he says he's going to run for city council. So that money would go to him, right? People's tax dollars would go to him.
If Vito Lopez does in fact run for office in the city for the city council in the city of New York, he could have whatever donations he gets matched 1-6 to 1 if it's under the donation limit. I mean, that doesn't root anybody out. It's, in fact, I imagine he would have a tough time raising money right now in view of the scandal. And if he has a tough time, the people in New York City are going to pay $6 to 1 to have him continue to represent people. Now, that's what they want the system for the state of New York. And I want to hasten to add, I'm not saying there can't be changes in campaign financial reform. In fact, one of the main problems is there's big donations right at the end of a campaign. And sometimes we don't know who those donations are from. And what was galling to me during this hearing was there's a preliminary statement by Senator Kachik, who beat the Republican candidate Amador in the race, New 63rd Senate District race. The 63rd Senate seat, she raised $600,000 from one of the Soros campaign organizations. And the reason she got $600,000 in the last two weeks of the campaign was because she was pushing for public financing. So she gets up at the hearing and she says, we've got to end big money in government. Big money got her there. She only won by about 20-something votes and the $600,000 from a group who wants public financing. I mean, I don't know. If that's not hypocritical, I don't understand the word. So it's not going to cure these situations. What I believe has to be done is more disclosure. These groups have to tell immediately where that money is coming from, not wait till the next campaign financing cycle, because that won't come out till after the election if you give money within the last 2 weeks. Immediately, that's got to be publicized, and people have to know where the money is coming from. And then you can make informed judgments.
Yeah, and the penalties need to be stiffer. Pensions need to be taken away.
Well, we can debate that one. Some people feel that, and I have my misgivings about that proposal, but I can see legitimate arguments on both sides.
Our next clip is about obligations of disclosure, and this is from someone who really favors a campaign finance system. He is a former deputy mayor of New York City, as well as an attorney who's worked on cases like this.
You know, I think that what we want to have is sunshine. We want to have everybody held to the same standard. Corporations, unions, unincorporated associations, political parties, all held to the same standard. And transparency and openness about when they are supposedly spending independently on campaigns.
So what is, it seems like the exemptions ate up the rule, didn't it?
Senator, didn't eat up a lot of the rule, because a lot of the rule involves spending and advocacy that necessarily happens outside of internal communications. A lot of association, party, union, and corporate spending is ads, radio, TV, getting out the vote, print ads, mailings. That's all covered by the disclosure obligation.
Just two more areas. One you mentioned about the disclosure is extremely important for some of these PACs that, for example, may put $500,000 into a campaign the last 3 weeks, and which to me is, it should be disclosed. I mean, it seems logical that if you guys have little Aunt Jenny who gives you $50 on the campaign website, these groups that are paying $500,000 to elect a candidate in the last 3 or 4 weeks, they should be identified.
And that's your position, correct?
Yes, and I believe one of the important things is that even to the extent there are disclosure obligations sometimes for independent groups, they're not on the same time schedule and held to the same standard as campaigns, which have increasingly shorter time frames for disclosing expenditures and contributions. The independent expenditure should be on the same timetable so that there can be disclosure and public awareness in real time, not after the fact.
All right. So during that, you could hear shouting in the background.
Well, that's true. And it's really interesting that the Democrats and the independent Democrats have had their own hearings on public financing, right, where the Republicans weren't invited. We had both sides in our hearing. And there was never any demonstration, because there's a point of view that they don't like to have heard, that meaning the these activists. And they claimed that the room wasn't big enough. I mean, we've had hearings in that room all the time. And I've had hearings as budget chairman, chairman of the Finance Committee in the budget process, where we have huge rooms, and they still demonstrate if their point of view is not the main focus of the discussion. So, you know, that became the whole story. And that's why I wanted to have this show, to explain what this public financing is all about and why people should just take a close look at it.
Right. And it was for the legislators to try to come up with ways and to listen to people to come up with ways. And it was streamed online. It was streamed on the Legislative Proceedings Channel, which is 83 in your district in Syracuse. And it's also on YouTube right now. Anyone could watch the whole 4 hours of it if they'd like.
Well, there's another part, too, that when I got there a little early. There were a lot of vacant chairs in that room. But the protesters were waiting at the door with their signs, making noise and everything else. If some of them wanted to be in there, they could easily gotten in there. I mean, in fact, one of the persons that was on YNN complaining about the closed door, she was in the room. I saw her there. You know, so there's an agenda, just like there's an agenda in a lot of things in government. So we want to get both sides out, and we're going to get both sides out.
All right. Thanks so much for being here today.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. Hope you join us next week, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.
I would like to point out for the record that the public that's being talked about is outside making noise, stomping their feet, screaming and yelling. And it would seem to me if they wanted to see this, there's plenty of public access to it through the media, through the live broadcast. And rather than have this disrupted, it would seem it's much more advantageous, because this is for the legislature to try to come up with solutions to serious problems, and the legislature that has to make this decision are in the room, and they should be able to do it unimpaired.